Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Calculus of Violence, How Americans Fought the Civil War, by Aaron Sheehan-Dean, narrated by Paul Boehmer. Introduction. The Puzzle of the Civil War. The U.S. Civil War was, by a wide measure, the bloodiest conflict in American history. It consumed 750,000 lives, including nearly one quarter of the white men of military age living in the South. The Civil War featured traditional battles that pitted uniformed soldiers against one another and gruesome acts of irregular warfare committed by guerrillas against regular soldiers and civilians. It incorporated hostage taking, imprisonment, banishment, and mass killings. Nonetheless, at many points, Northerners and Southerners chose restraint. Soldiers on both sides took prisoners, respected flags of truce, and directed their weapons at each other rather than at non-combatants. Politicians and citizens demanded their nations observe the laws of war, and enslaved people sought freedom rather than revenge in the chaos of the conflict. If not for these actions, the already high death toll could have escalated dramatically. In order to understand this puzzle, a catastrophic war that could have been much worse, this book examines how people on both sides justified the lethal violence of the conflict and when, how, and why they balanced cruelty and destruction with restraint and mercy. Who could be killed in the Civil War? Who could do that killing? How did they justify their actions? In short, why was the Civil War so bloody? And conversely, how did participants avoid what Lincoln most feared, a remorseless revolutionary struggle? The answers lie in the thoughts and actions of the Civil War's participants. Sometimes they drew upon deeply held beliefs, and at other times they acted spontaneously in unanticipated situations. The answers changed over time, and in the uncertainty of war, participants contradicted themselves from moment to moment. As a result, the patterns of violence in the conflict did not follow a path of steady growth. The limited to total war paradigm, which argues that the war inexorably grew more violent each year, dominates both academic and popular histories of the war. But it mischaracterizes the conflict. The reassurance offered by this narrative, common to descriptions of nearly all wars, conceals the more complicated reality of a conflict in which local patterns of violence and peace varied across time and space. In some places, the war was more unrestrained in 1861 than 1865, and in other places, the opposite held true. The Civil War was not either restrained or violent. It was both. Malice and charity occurred simultaneously, sometimes in the same places. Moving beyond a binary formulation helps us see the ways in which people understood some acts of violence as immoral and wasteful, and others as necessary and just. This book brings together the regular and irregular aspects of the war. It examines the behavior of politicians, officers, soldiers, guerrillas, prisoners, and citizens. It analyzes what they did and how they justified what they did. It explores the gaps and discrepancies between action and rhetoric, between reality and theory. The result is an analysis of the war that operates on two levels. Within the conflict, I track how Federals and Confederates engaged with each other over those issues that could most easily enable lethal violence to spiral out of control. Guerrillas, emancipation, prisoners, and occupation. If we look only at the ground level and focus on these issues, as previous historians have done, we see a war that is often bloody and only occasionally restrained. If we pull back, employ hindsight, and broaden the frame of reference to include other civil and national conflicts in the mid-19th century, the American experience appears unusual for the degree of restraint exercised by participants. These conflicting conclusions, that the Civil War was defined by unnecessary violence and death, and also by restraint, are produced by shifting our own perspective on the event, as we must do with the passage of time. Recognizing that the U.S. Civil War, compared to contemporaneous conflicts, included more moments of restraint and charity does not minimize the degree of suffering, even unjust suffering, born during the conflict. Like F. Scott Fitzgerald's definition of first-rate intelligence, a full understanding of the Civil War requires that we hold two contrary ideas in our heads simultaneously. In three important spheres of the war, participants engaged each other in ways that discouraged restraint and escalated the war's violence. The Confederacy's willingness to tolerate guerrillas proved a fateful choice. Their presence in the war subjected non-combatants to lethal violence and compelled the Union to devise a counterinsurgency strategy that exacted a devastating toll on Southern civilians. In response to the Union's mid-war endorsement of emancipation and its enlistment of black men into U.S. armies, the Confederacy subjected black soldiers to unjust violence throughout the conflict. The last factor stimulating violence was the strong sense of nationalism that bound participants to their cause and encouraged a vision of the enemy as corrupt and unworthy. This message came from newspaper editors, politicians' speeches, and ministers' sermons, and it increased over the course of the war, compelling people to fight longer and tolerate greater bloodshed, both their own and their enemies. The most important restraining influence countering these forces was the state. In the Union and the Confederacy, central governments set limits on violence. Because both states curried the favor of international observers, they professed adherence to the laws of war, which sanctioned lethal violence only against combatants. Neither side observed this principle perfectly, but the experience of the Civil War reveals that states matter. The most destructive 19th century wars, like the Caste War of the Yucatan or the Taiping Civil War, involved actors who did not aspire to statehood or who rejected the Western laws of war. The state's role in regulating behavior can be seen in several ways. First, both places practiced regular war, with the important exception of the Confederacy's use of guerrillas. Even potentially catastrophic moments like sieges and artillery bombardments of towns and cities occurred in legal and deliberate ways. Second, both sides took prisoners of war rather than treating enemy combatants as criminals and executing them, as happened in the wake of the Paris Commune in 1871. Although many Civil War prisoners suffered and died needlessly while incarcerated. Third, despite the outcry by Confederate civilians, Union occupants of Southern cities rarely entailed much lethal violence. One last factor that manifested itself through official channels also encouraged moderation in the Union's pursuit of military victory. Abraham Lincoln, most U.S. military officers, and a majority of the Republican Party regarded Confederates as wayward citizens who could be restored to loyalty and then to full civil life. Black Northerners and white abolitionists opposed this view and sanctioned a more destructive and sometimes more violent conflict with the Confederacy. But they rarely held the levers of power. This political dynamic ensured that the Northerners who created and implemented war policy restrained themselves in ways that did not occur in similar conflicts in other places. Any useful study of violence in the war must take stock of victims' attitudes as well as perpetrators. The story begins with how each side justified their resort to war. I also consider how they explained the violence they committed. During the war, we can see cycles of conflict, escalation, and resolution in different places at different times. So we move chronologically through each crucial event of the war in many theaters. These cycles varied over time. Sometimes the war's participants produced more violence under the guise of retribution, and sometimes participants deterred additional violence. The experiences of the Civil War do not reflect some natural or inevitable escalation of violence that rules all wars. For instance, in 1863, the Union endorsed emancipation as a war strategy, which the Confederacy regarded as a violation of the rules of war. Confederate President Jefferson Davis then announced a policy of killing rather than capturing black soldiers. In response, Lincoln issued his own threat to retaliate against Confederate prisoners. Confederates never treated black soldiers fairly, but neither did they execute all those they defeated in battle. Similarly, Lincoln did not execute captured Confederates. The narrative that follows examines these cycles, the moments that ignited them, and how actors on both sides took responsibility for suppressing them. The pattern of violence in the war was uneven, contingent, and often contradictory. I spend ample time considering Lincoln and Davis, but this story, of necessity, ranges across the full spectrum of politicians, legal scholars, military officers, enlisted men, and regular citizens whose actions together shaped the war. I chronicle the attitudes and behavior of different constituencies over time. Americans divided by region, ideology, race, and religion in their perspectives toward military violence. Even if we could isolate each of these variables, the task would be a hard one. These forces interacted with each other in unpredictable ways. For instance, some evangelical Protestants, mostly abolitionists, began the war as committed pacifists, but the prospect of emancipation inspired many of them to support the war and, surprisingly, to advocate vigorous conduct against the South. Northern and Southern blacks differed, too, with the former espousing aggressive policies, while the latter, hemmed in by armed whites on all sides, pursued more cautious strategies. Northern policymakers, such as Abraham Lincoln and moderate Republican congressmen, sought a full and equitable reconciliation of both regions. They recognized early on that unnecessary violence would only exacerbate the difference and alienate Southerners from the national government. A vocal body of white elites in the North promoted moderation in war. Some of these were recent converts to the Republican Party, while others remained within the ranks of the Democratic Party. They were counterbalanced by black elites, such as Frederick Douglass, and some white abolitionists who promoted a more aggressive war. This shift also came from the bottom up, because Northern soldiers experienced a profound disillusionment during their first year in the South. They expected to be greeted by the non-slaveholding majority of the region as liberators, but were more often regarded as invaders and repulsed with whatever tools could be mustered. Soldiers reacted by encouraging a harsher treatment of white civilians, whom they assumed to be disloyal and potential supporters of guerrilla units, which they often were. Those same soldiers grew more generous toward enslaved people as they came to support the plans of radicals in the North who saw the war as an opportunity to destroy the power of slaveholders and remake the region. Confederate society possessed at least as many divisions as did the North. During the war, Southern policymakers sanctioned harsh treatment of the enemy, most importantly with regard to black Union troops. But even here, there were moderates who advocated adherence to the laws of war, if only in the strategic hopes of earning European support. Like their northern peers, southern soldiers sometimes diverged from official policy, often mistreating southern civilians if they suspected them of Unionism. Confederate soldiers also exceeded their ambiguous orders and inflicted cruel and lethal violence on black soldiers. Even more than in the North, social cleavages divided Confederate society. Dissenters and enslaved people represented a serious internal threat. Their actions, often geared around personal or family survival, complicated Confederate efforts to govern. Last, the South produced a wide range of irregular combatants, some of whom supported the Confederacy, some of whom opposed it, and still others who engaged in murder and plunder for personal gain. Most historians limit their analysis to North America when studying the war, but this method distorts the nature of the conflict and its place in history. Approaching the question of violence and morality in the Civil War from a global context allows us to recognize that the conflict was not the bloodiest civil war, either in terms of absolute numbers of casualties or when weighed by population. These distinctions belong, respectively, to China's Taiping Rebellion, which claimed the lives of over 20 million people between 1850 to 1864, and Mexico's caste war of the Yucatan, 1847 to 1872, which killed 35% of the region's population. A global framework restores the perspective of the war's participants, who saw their conflict through the lens of past conflicts, and partly explains how and why they acted the way they did. The laws of war, to which participants made continuous reference, both limited and exacerbated the violence of the conflict. Respect for the laws of war created standards that also operated internally. Each nation's populace policed itself. Because these were both modern democracies, dissenting and supporting constituencies demanded that their armies behave in ways that reflected people's fundamentally benevolent vision of themselves. But for all the restraint that both sides manifested, and they talked more about restraint than they practiced it, they also authorized and accepted atrocities. Genuine noncombatants suffered hardship, banishment, property seizure, detention, and death. The North banished citizens that supported guerrillas from its occupied cities and, in the most extreme case, 20,000 inhabitants of western Missouri. Global influences could also encourage violence when it concerned the effort to maintain a civilized nation against that of the savage. Both North and South identified themselves with a crusading, European virtue, and their enemy with a barbaric, immoral nature. The U.S. Civil War was not a world war in the modern sense of total engagement and impact, but it drew the attention of observers around the world. Participants framed their arguments in global terms and broadcast their positions to every person who would listen and possibly lend them aid. The world of the 19th century differed from our own in important ways, most importantly for this story, because of the rising prominence of nation-states. The war's participants made nationalism a central force in the Civil War, inspiring solidarity with one another and hatred for their enemy. At the same time, claiming nationhood for both North and South required citizens to behave as modern, civilized people should. Sometimes, This meant committing the violence necessary to ensure the success of their way of life, and at other times it meant abstaining from violence to claim the moral high ground in the eyes of the world. The result was a war that left us a seeming paradox, a catastrophically bloody conflict that could have been much worse. This civil war does not yield the heroes that so often populate our stories, but it does reveal the ordinary people, acting intentionally but without perfect foresight, hoping to win a virtuous war and sometimes committing atrocities, who stumbled through the conflict. This story is full of surprises. Enslaved people, who had the greatest claim to righteous fury, abjured violence and sought their freedom instead. Soldiers on both sides observed the customary laws of war by generally respecting the lives of non-combatants. But at times, they also cynically manipulated the law to sanction greater violence. For instance, Northern soldiers referred to their own rules of conduct to defend the summary execution of guerrillas and unnecessary violence against civilians. Confederate soldiers referred to the law to defend wanton cruelty and murder against black Union troops. Commanders, North and South, justified their hard war against soldiers and civilians by resort to necessity. But over time, they also developed an apparatus of military law and oversight that tempered those measures. The democratic structure of both nations produced a similar split vision. The public of both regions lived a vicarious war that encouraged a descent into violence and bloodshed. But the presence of minority parties and dissenting politicians in both sections ensured the persistence of contrary voices. And despite all the violence and bloodshed, the laws of war helped produce meaningful boundaries. Civilians never became direct targets of lethal violence as they had in Indian wars of the previous decades and as they did in 20th century conflicts. From these sometimes contradictory trends, Northerners and Southerners created a calculus of violence that helped them respond to the contingencies of the conflict. In mathematics, calculus empowers its users to determine points along a curve or the area encompassed by it. It operates according to natural law and generates accurate predictions. No such certainty, however, could be found in the Civil War. Participants fashioned a wartime calculus through which they balanced the moral, strategic, and political dimensions of their actions. But that calculus itself changed as the war evolved. Neither the U.S. nor the CS governments maintained a monopoly on violence. As in other conflicts, both institutional and individual actors seized opportunities to perpetrate violence to advance their own ends. Usually, these irregular combatants were classified as guerrillas or bushwhackers. Sometimes, third parties acted in synchrony with the goals of the nation to which they pledged loyalty. And in other cases, they used national affiliation to mask personal or communal vengeance or simple financial opportunity. In recent years, scholars have grouped such actions under the heading of guerrilla warfare. While earlier generations of historians saw guerrilla conflict as marginal, current scholars view it as central to understanding the experience of the Civil War. The guerrilla war is usually mapped into an East-West framework that cleanly divides the regular war from the irregular war. We now have a good sense of where guerrillas operated and of the Union's counterinsurgency strategies. As a result, we can map these zones and identify the dangerous ground where these spaces overlapped and guerrillas and soldiers found each other in their sights. The linear connotation of zones, in fact, misrepresents these areas, which were porous and unevenly shaped. We might more profitably imagine periodically colliding waves. Sometimes, when waves intersect, a larger one absorbs the smaller one and the water returns to calm. This occurred when uniformed soldiers met guerrillas and captured them instead of killing them. Other waves crash together and create a higher peak that unleashes more turbulence. Sometimes in the Civil War, regular soldiers responded to guerrilla attacks with executions and town burnings. The intersection of these contrary modes of fighting created a more dangerous world for everyone. Whether we think of them as zones or waves, we need to integrate the experiences of the war's irregular dimension into the standard accounts of regular military action. One of the challenges of any history is finding a language that accurately represents the historical reality of the past while making sense to current listeners. Anachronistic terms create a false continuity between past and present. Antiquated terms alienate listeners and encourage us to regard ourselves as uniquely virtuous. In this case, we are confronted by the same words, but ones whose underlying meaning has changed. A 19th century just war is not a 21st century just war. The shifting definitions of justice over the last century and a half, to say nothing of the differences between St. Augustine's time and ours, complicate any analysis of the nature of violence in the Civil War. This temporal difference is part of why behavior that may appear cruel or vindictive to us appeared natural and proper to Civil War Americans. We also need precise language. Although historians of the Civil War have offered increasingly thoughtful and capricious histories of the conflict, when they turn to the war's violence, the terms become more elusive and obscure. Cities are devastated, destroyed, or obliterated. But burning the public buildings of a town or even its private homes is not the same as killing its inhabitants. The latter rarely occurred in the Civil War, though it was commonplace in 20th century warfare. This was a difference that mattered to the war's participants, and it should be clear to listeners. In what follows, I take pains to distinguish between Union and Confederate definitions of fair and responsible behavior in war. They began the war with similar perspectives, but diverged quickly over guerrillas, occupation, emancipation, and prisoners. Confederates denounced the U.S. Army's treatment of Southern citizens from the war's opening moments. The fatal break came with the Union's enlistment of black soldiers, which Confederates regarded as a breach of civilized behavior in war. In turn, Northerners regarded the Confederates' willingness to mistreat and often murder black soldiers as evidence of Southern depravity. Because wars are dialectical processes, the narrative that follows offers a holistic account of the nature of Civil War violence. Northern and Southern contestants defined their own virtue and their failings based partly on their opponent's position. When military officers negotiated with the enemy, usually through letters, they often changed their behavior, even while denying any wrongdoing. Participants on both sides adjusted their moral reckoning with the war in relation to each other. Instead of posing the question, was the Civil War a just war, which has led some historians to impute a single meaning to the conflict, my goal is to investigate how participants defined justice in the midst of war. Declaring a conflict just after its conclusion is the purview of ethicists and does little to help us understand why or how it happened. As a historian, my hope is to enable listeners to see the contrary conceptions of violence and mercy that animated Northerners and Southerners in the Civil War. As in most wars, people on each side believed they had the stronger claims to justice, but events forced them to reevaluate the wartime calculus and their right to this moral high ground. My concern is not with adjudicating the past, but with explaining how people believed they were right. With such a background, listeners may draw their own conclusions. Evaluating the violence of the Civil War from the perspective of the participants' moral frameworks forces us to confront the war not as a tragic misunderstanding between brothers, but as a violent conflict, like so many others. It forces us to admit wrongdoing on both sides. This latter admission topples America from its perch, a city on a hill, a beacon of virtue, and a model of democratic civility for the world to emulate. Instead, a full recognition of both the horror and the civility of the Civil War positions the United States within the mainstream of history. A study of the war's violence is also important in moral terms. For many Americans, our current sense of the Civil War's meaning in American life hinges on two truisms. First, that it destroyed slavery, and second, that the human cost was enormous. For Lincoln, these two facts expressed a mathematical relationship. Every drop of blood drawn with the lash shall be paid by another drawn with the sword. Revisionist historians of the 1920s and 1930s, some of whom regarded slavery as a benevolent institution, rejected Lincoln's logic. They did not believe the liberation of 4 million people was worth the war's cost. Today, most Americans take the opposite view, retaining something of Lincoln's sense of cosmic justice that the deaths of Union and Confederate soldiers redeemed, in some way, the gross injustice of American slavery. Using the war's outcome to justify its course may make good politics, but it makes poor history. Instead, we need to investigate the violence of the Civil War during the war years rather than going backward from Northern victory and emancipation. It is also true that historians too often write about the war as an autonomous force, all the more so in an age of unlimited and timeless war on terror. But in a democracy, the choices that voters and citizens make about who they support and the military policies they condone structure what our armies do on the ground. Lincoln knew this as well, which is why at the end of the war he tried to steer a Northern public, buoyed by a victory that confirmed their sense of righteousness, back toward a more conciliatory posture. In March 1865, when Lincoln promised malice toward none and charity toward all, he was looking forward to a post-war era in which he would be responsible for integrating ex-Confederates into the national fabric. Charity, as Lincoln and his contemporaries understood it, required that they judge and treat others, especially opponents, with a generous spirit. Lincoln announced his intention because it marked a change from how the war had been fought. For Northerners and Southerners, malice and charity defined the boundaries of the wartime calculus. For those who have seen the horrors of war firsthand, perhaps the simultaneous presence of malice and charity seems routine, but historians have been slow to appreciate what it means for the Civil War. Kurt Vonnegut, who witnessed some of the worst moments of World War II, opened his novel Slaughterhouse-Five or The Children's Crusade by asserting that there is nothing intelligent to say about a massacre. 19th century Americans held a more optimistic view of the possibility of learning from history, even the most painful kind. George Caleb Bingham, painter, politician, and Union soldier argued after the Civil War that the burnt child dreads the fire, only because the hurtful properties of that element are impressed upon its memory by the injury they have inflicted. If it suffers itself to forget them, it profits nothing from its costly experience and is liable to be burnt again. In like manner, Bingham believed, the history which fails to record the public and individual crimes which convulse society and sap the foundations of civil liberty leaves future generations exposed to like evils from like fatal causes. Perhaps I have more of the 19th century than the 20th in me. I retain enough optimism to believe that trying to say something intelligent about a massacre is a worthy cause. With all due respect to Mr. Vonnegut, this study examines the fire in the hope that we will not burn ourselves again. Chapter 1. Who Can Make War? Even the most casual student of American history knows the terrible death toll of the Civil War. The foundational role of this information in histories of the conflict may lead us to think that Americans anticipated or easily accepted the war's increasingly high casualties. In fact, the war's participants had to reconcile themselves to the conflict's scale at each new threshold, never knowing where its pinnacle lay. It would be easy to assume, as some do, that the war's violence flowed naturally from irreconcilable animosity between the regions. In this telling, the American Iliad derives its tragedy from the same source as its Greek ancestor. Rage, goddess, sing the rage of Peleus's son Achilles. Disagreement over the fate of slavery drove Northerners and Southerners to envision each other as enemies. Deceit, betrayal, and wounded honor compelled Yankee and rebel, as it did Achilles and Agamemnon. The bitter invective spewed by wartime commentators lends credence to this interpretation. But the full historical record offers a more mixed portrait of attitudes toward both the enemy and wartime violence. To be sure, pre-war political conflicts, mostly over slavery, alienated Northerners and Southerners. By 1860, many believed their differences made continued coexistence impossible. At the same time, the connections built over decades of national life continued to exist. Federals and Confederates were not inevitable enemies. The way they fought and the ways they explained and justified how they fought generated much of the antagonism in the war. Only a few lines after so clearly identifying the motive of the Trojan War, Homer poses a similar question. What god drove them to fight with such a fury? Not having recourse to the meddlesome Greek pantheon, we must identify the sources of fury among Northerners and Southerners themselves. Unexceptional America. Americans entered the Civil War with strongly held ideas about nationhood, war, and violence. The dynamism and unpredictability of the conflict compelled some to abandon old ways of thinking, while others found their beliefs confirmed. Regardless, all Americans tested the new conceptions, habits, and attitudes they formed during the bewildering changes of the 1840s and 1850s. Three categories of thought shaped the war most profoundly. First, how did people think about their communities and their nation? What held people together and legitimized their voice? Second, what were the attitudes about morality and the law generally? Third, what was the nature and experience of violence in antebellum America? 19th century Americans. Americans in both North and South lived local lives before the Civil War. National and even state government touched most people lightly, and the economic, social, and cultural communities that shaped their lives existed within a day's horse ride. Throughout the 1840s and 1850s, Americans built networks to connect these places. Some networks, like railroads, canals, and turnpikes, were physical pathways, while others, like newspapers and the postal system, created virtual communities as subscribers and readers exchanged ideas with strangers linked by common religions, political ideologies, or charitable motives. But the presence of these connections, which tied Americans to new national and even global markets for goods, ideas, and practices, did little to disrupt the essentially small-scale communities of antebellum America. This meant that when the war came, Americans experienced it at different scales. Missourians and Arkansans knew the guerrilla conflict. Virginians and Tennesseans knew the habits and effects of regular armies. Coastal communities along the Mississippi River and the Atlantic Ocean knew occupation. Northerners experienced the war through letters of soldier relatives and newspaper reporting. The war narrative assembled by participants was fragmented. With hindsight, we possess a panoptic view that encompasses all these various aspects, but this was not how the war looked to those who experienced it, even for those men at the center of their respective nations who had the media at their command. Some events broke through the local frameworks in which most people were immersed. Presidential speeches and newspaper reporting offered a common language of people, events, and practices. In what follows, we need to consider both the broad historical perspective that explains outcomes and the contemporary, blinkered view that explains why people made the decisions they did from one moment to the next. The changing structure of the mid-century economy facilitated a more destructive war in the South. In the antebellum decades, the United States developed an increasingly commercial economy and one with active markets in corporate stocks and government bonds. For Northerners, this meant a dynamic commercial economy that could shift with surprising speed into war production. In contrast, the vast majority of Southerners' wealth existed in the form of property and slaves. During the Civil War, these proved much more vulnerable to seizure and destruction than the North's commercial resources. Politics was in transition, too. By the 1850s, nearly all Northern and Southern states had liberalized their voting and office-holding requirements. The rise of the second two-party system, which pitted Whigs against Democrats, energized voters and enabled a vibrant culture of partisan politics. The elites who controlled politics pursued public policies that favored native-born white men, creating a sense of entitlement about the purpose of American politics. The responsiveness of that system meant that people in both sections felt empowered to monitor, debate, and help shape military policy during the conflict. Daily newspapers flourished in both parts of the United States, contributing to the new political infrastructure. By 1860, readers around the country devoured hundreds of daily newspapers, many with national reach. Most editors affiliated themselves with a political party and published material that advocated their beliefs. Despite these partisan roots, the collective system of the American media gave access to diverse voices. These papers circulated information faster and more broadly than any previous medium in wartime. Although the immediate after-battle reports coming over telegraph wires from the first generation of war reporters were notoriously inaccurate, the volume and flow of information shaped how the war happened. The competition among newspapers ensured that most reports had outlets, and the expanding audience encouraged editors to find provocative stories. The political disputes generated by the Civil War, as well as the daily narrative of bloodshed and drama, provided more opportunities to attract new readers than editors could handle. Papers played an outsized role in shaping public attitudes throughout the war. The economic and political institutions of American life did not create the bloodshed of the Civil War, but they did create a more interconnected, polarized public familiar with and even eager to consume information amid the mayhem of modern life. Because Southern leaders organized the new nation around the protection of racial slavery, it may seem odd to designate Confederate society a democratic one. Abolitionists and anti-slavery Republicans certainly objected to the designation. They regarded the antebellum and Confederate South as aristocratic societies. No consensus about the essential features of a democratic society existed in the 1850s, even among Northerners, and most of the markers that we use today, universal adult suffrage, full civil rights, and an independent press, did not exist. The salient democratic features of the Confederacy were a representative political system, competitive elections, a free press, and the presence of a strong dissenting political tradition. Because of these institutions and practices, the Confederacy operated much like the United States in terms of the participation of the general public in setting the nature and course of the war. Values and the law. What values defined Americans mid-century? Many citizens, though certainly not all, developed moral frameworks grounded in the evangelical Protestantism that emerged from the Second Great Awakening of the 1830s. This movement called them to renew or initiate a faith that would purge sin from the world. The effort to build a more Christian world took slightly different shape in different parts of the country. In the North, adherents campaigned for the reform of prisons and other places of suffering, for temperance, for respect for the dignity of all people, and among the more radical believers, for women's rights and the abolition of slavery. Northerners and Southerners clashed over the particular content of the social reforms that various groups advocated, but they came together around a belief in the justice, goodness, and naturalness of the United States as a historical entity. Regardless of the regional particulars, adherents of the Second Great Awakening celebrated the New Testament messages of hope and salvation. The wrathful God of the Old Testament never disappeared from view. He often starred in wartime tracts, but the benevolent message of Jesus attained more prominence. For strict adherence to this new evangelical faith, the war presented a serious challenge. Some devout Northern abolitionists refused to abandon their pacifism to support the Union war effort. Many others accommodated themselves to the conflict, reasoning that the good that would come from emancipation outweighed the bad inherent in military conflict. But even those who found a way to reconcile their religious beliefs and the violence of war experienced a persistent tension. Alongside religion existed a body of philosophical and legal thought articulating modern ethics. The law offered a rational and transparent system to regulate behavior. One of the most important works, International Law or Rules Regulating the Intercourse of States, was written by Henry W. Halleck, a U.S. Army officer, and soon to be Lincoln's General-in-Chief. During the Mexican-American War, Halleck served as a legal advisor on the staff of the commander of the Pacific Squadron. Halleck's treatise rested on the substantial body of writing on nations, laws, and war developed by Europeans over the preceding centuries. It was an ample tome. The book opened with a historical survey of writing on international law and war, beginning with the ancient Jews and continuing for 907 pages through hundreds of years of European history, ending with the contemporary United States. Halleck's book substituted for the absence of specific rules in the military regulations of the U.S. and Articles of War, the two official volumes published by the Army. Halleck offered the closest thing to a manual of conduct then available, albeit one burdened by detailed citations. Halleck's footnotes sometimes consumed more space than the text itself. His average citation ran several lines and referenced many works. This was not a case of academic pedantry run amok. Halleck established a foundation for his rules that readers would respect. He grounded the work in European history and thought, intending the sheer volume of his citation system to guide, but also overwhelm readers. They could check each of his notes, but were more likely to marvel at the weight of Western tradition they represented, which clearly lay on the side of the nations and the lawyers. The most important wartime commentator on the laws of war, the German-born Francis Lieber, was likewise steeped in the classic literature. Lieber's fame rests on his facility at translating the historical rules surrounding just war theory into 19th-century practice. These rules came to be called the Lieber Code, used as General Orders No. 100 in April 1863 to the U.S. Army. In 1861, Lieber gained renown when he published a set of public lectures on the laws of war in the New York Times, which was reprinted in other national papers. These legal scholars and philosophers hoped to build a recognizable and enforceable collection of the laws of war. But before the Civil War commenced, they were mostly writing and speaking to one another. It is safe to assume that few outside the War Department read Halleck's volume, but they still held opinions about the laws of war. In the decades before the Civil War, common people regarded the law as a public, social, and fluid institution. This attitude continued during the Civil War, when most people treated the laws of war as a set of practices and beliefs undergirded by experience and history, something more akin to the common law of the antebellum era than to the intellectual apparatus articulated by Lieber. For lawyers, especially military officers, Lieber, Halleck, and the European Emma de Fattel served as the foundation when they implemented the laws of war in the war itself. Just as common people understood and used the law, so they framed their ethical understanding of the world through the patterns they absorbed from history. Few people received the thorough grounding that luminaries like Jefferson and Madison drew upon to frame the Declaration and Constitution two generations earlier, but nonetheless, popular and private conversations during the war reveal the deep imprint of historical examples and analogies that helped Americans make sense of their conflict. They drew upon ancient, European, and more recent global conflicts to interpret their own actions. Most Americans, North and South, assumed the United States occupied a special place in world history. Lincoln called the nation the last best of hope of earth. But they also saw how easily the country could follow the dispiriting examples of other peoples. Mexico served as a cautionary tale, a republic that could not maintain itself. The political turmoil of Mexico in the 1840s and 1850s conjured the nightmare that would come with Confederate victory. If the United States submits to a division now, it will not stop, but will go on until we reap the fate of Mexico, which is eternal war, William T. Sherman prophesied. To avoid these dangers required confidence, will, and force. Watching the success of the British as they built a global empire, many Americans learned that sometimes violence was necessary to expand civilization. The debate about the legitimate ways to maintain national unity was an old problem. Educated Americans, rooted in Greek history, in particular, Pericles's famous funeral oration, memorializing Athenian soldiers killed in their campaign against the Spartans during the Peloponnesian War. This speech became a touchstone in the 19th century and served as a reference for Lincoln at the dedication of the Gettysburg Cemetery. Our record of Pericles' words comes from the historian Thucydides, and most Americans would have read his words as a celebration of the virtues of Athenian democracy. In Thucydides' view, Athenian freedom made them powerful, and they used that power to advance the cause of liberty, even through war. Make up your minds that happiness depends on being free, and freedom depends on being courageous. Let there be no relaxation in the face of the perils of the war. Far from it. Thucydides conveys both the benefits and dangers of making war upon a free power like Athens. Our adventurous spirit has forced an entry into every sea and into every land, and everywhere we have left behind us everlasting memorials of good done to our friends or suffering inflicted on our enemies. Regardless of the particular lessons Americans drew from the past, they believed that they could draw clear moral conclusions about the causes and meaning of military conflict. This perspective is so different from our modern, often cynical posture that it bears mention. Consider the attitude of one of the North's leading ministers in late 1861. It is a matter of thanksgiving that this war promises to solve those difficult problems which have baffled the wisdom of our wisest counselors. Henry Ward Beecher's cultural opposite, the pro-slavery theorist George Fitzhugh, came to a similar conclusion, writing that wars came because God, who is wiser than we, has instituted them for salutary purposes and promoted mankind to prepare for them. This faith in war to solve social and political problems was widely shared by Americans both North and South. Antebellum violence. For at least the last several decades, Americans have regarded themselves as an unusually violent people. Studies, polls, and anecdotal reporting all indicate that residents of the United States recognize that they live in a more violent society than any comparable Western industrialized democracy. Further, many people read this evidence backward in time. They assume that because more Americans die of gun violence than the residents of any other nation, this must always have been the case. It is a curious case of inverted American exceptionalism in which the thing that marks the United States as distinct is our least desirable characteristic. But only a few decades ago, a host of researchers reached the opposite conclusion. Their studies demonstrated that Americans before the 20th century lived violent lives, but no more violent than the residents of comparable places around the globe. What, then, was the nature of American violence before the Civil War? What were Americans' attitudes toward warfare and killing? What sources did they draw upon to form these attitudes? These questions are essential to answer clearly before we can attempt any assessment of why people behaved in the ways that they did during the war itself. Violence played a central role in the creation of European colonies in the New World in the 17th and 18th centuries. After decades of ignoring its role or of subsuming it under the rubric of encounters, historians now recognize the terrible violence committed against and among native peoples all across the Americas. The territory Europeans explored and occupied was already filled with interpersonal and communal violence. As the British came to dominate North America, they harnessed war and killing to support land acquisition and control of labor. Almost from the point of first contact, Anglo-Americans regarded violence as a legitimate tool in their efforts to subdue native populations. According to one student of this process, bloodshed lies at the heart of the American experience. From the onset of the Seven Years' War in 1754, she writes, until the United States' victory 41 years later at the Battle of Fallen Timbers, atrocity and retaliation turned the West into a dark and bloody ground, from the Mohawk Valley to the Carolinas, from the Great Lakes to Kentucky. This pattern of violent interaction continued in the 19th century in a national rather than imperial context. Americans experienced a series of terrible clashes between Native communities and the U.S. government in the decades after the War of 1812. These involved the forcible dispossession and exile of thousands of people from their homes in the southeastern United States. The violence culminated in three wars with the Seminoles, which ended only in 1842. The long 19th century opened in the fratricidal conflicts of the American, French, and Haitian revolutions. National and civil wars around the globe consumed millions of lives before the century culminated in the apocalypse of World War I. In the new, crowded cities, fueled by industrial growth and conflict that came to typify the modern world, interpersonal violence took the lives of many. Lethal violence, defined by murder rates, escalated in the United States in the 1840s and 1850s. It did so for a variety of reasons. The influx of immigrants, who intensified job competition and cultural anxiety among the native-born, regional conflicts over slavery's expansion, political disputes over the country's future, racial violence inside and outside of slavery, and class conflict as the market economy upset old standards. All of these factors transpired against a background of historical dismay and lack of confidence in the government and the nation itself. The arbitrary nature of the era's violence increased people's sense of their own vulnerability. In addition to the personal violence that characterized the era, the political struggle over slavery had overflowed the churches in which it started, coursed through Congress, and spilled into the open in the mid-1850s. From the plains of Kansas, where pro- and anti-slavery forces fought each other, to the abolitionist and anti-abolitionist riots of northeastern cities, the elemental brutality of slavery engulfed many people beyond plantation boundaries. Yet, even while some Americans accepted the use of mass violence to further their political or social agendas, others drew away. Abolitionists and evangelicals rejected the casual killing practiced in Jacksonian America. Pacifists criticized American militarism in the Seminole Wars and the Mexican-American War of the 1840s. These competing currents ensured that the Americans who lived through the Civil War entered it seasoned by public debate and personal introspection over the proper way to wage war. In both North and South, violence was pervasive, but also contained within certain parameters. In the South, personal violence suffused and defined slavery. A whole world of violent acts that free people never faced would be committed against enslaved persons. White Southerners used violence against enslaved people continually, from routine beatings or discipline that occurred in all manner of public and private settings, to the vivid signs on enslaved people's bodies as punishment for the attempted escapes and other high crimes. The evidence of slavery's violence was omnipresent. Southern historians rarely consider the impact of this daily exposure on popular attitudes toward violence itself, but abolitionists and even many conservative Northerners assumed it reduced white Southerners' sympathy for suffering more generally. Northerners saw evidence of this as soon as the war started. Charles Wills, an Illinois soldier, described the whip marks on the back of a white Alabamian who joined his regiment. "His back looks harder than anyone I ever saw." the man had received 30 lashes because of his support for the Union in the war's opening days. Still, he was luckier than the 9 men hanged for the same offense the day before he lit out for the North. Slavery made violence in the South different from that in the North. Violent punishment of enslaved people happened everywhere and in every context in the antebellum South. The public nature of these acts, which ran the gamut from simple chastisement to outright killings, made violence pervasive in Southern life. Another important regional difference was the greater role Southern white women assumed in the punishment of enslaved people. Although men occupied the primary positions as protectors of the slave system, mistresses also used violence in their supervision and direction of slaves within and outside their homes. With rare exceptions, neither masters nor mistresses were punished for the harm they inflicted on their slaves. In cases where owners beat or killed their slaves and such actions reverberated in the community, as they often did given the degree of cross-plantation marriage and family networks, other masters might informally censure such behavior, but masters rarely faced legal prosecution for actions taken against enslaved people. The result was a culture that sanctioned elite-sponsored violence against social inferiors and expected that such practices could exist within an otherwise orderly and lawful society. These would prove to be perfect preconditions for the irregular violence that racked much of the South during the war. The system of slavery structured the role of violence in Southern life, both between blacks and whites, and among whites themselves. Slaves used violence to rebel, and increasingly in the 19th century, anti-slavery activists used violence to try and destroy the system. Accounts of chilling cruelty by masters toward slaves circulated widely throughout the antebellum period. Although denounced by slavery's sympathizers as aberrations or exaggerations, photographs and records of the physical evidence on slaves' bodies and the mental implements of torture and confinement that rest today in museums reveal the constitutive role that violence played in managing American slavery. Some slaves lashed out at owners, and enslaved people organized at least 54 slave revolts or conspiracies between the Revolution and the Civil War. But the counter-response by whites to these events, whether they were isolated acts of personal violence or broader political movements, generated higher death tolls than the liberation efforts themselves. A different constellation of potential violence encircled white men in the cult of honor. Although duels occupy much of the historical imagination, violence enacted to preserve or redeem honor often involved other types of personal attacks. In 1825, the mayor of Pensacola, Florida, Peter Alba Jr., described as a man of gigantic size and athletic strength, jumped Joseph White, a fellow politician and opponent of Alba's friend Richard Call, and began hitting him with a club. Alba's intent was to cut off White's ears. He had brought a stiletto along for the procedure, but White wrestled free and escaped. For the next decade, White and Call and their allies and stand-ins continued to battle for physical and political supremacy in frontier Florida. Most Southern men understood that the two elements, bodily integrity and political leadership, reinforced one another. If Alba had succeeded, White would have carried a public mark of his inferiority and probably lost the support of his followers. As scholars have shown, the cult of masculine honor structured much of the Southern social and political world before the Civil War. According to one historian, Southern men considered politics and rhetoric personal matters, and their inability to ignore insults infused the whole system with violence. The necessity of maintaining a good image in public required immediate and often violent responses to threats or slights to one's honor. The particular nature of American politics in the antebellum period amplified the potential for harm resulting from Southern interpretations of honor. According to another historian, politics raised the stakes of honor. Nowhere was the possible esteem higher, nowhere the danger of assault on one's honor greater. Honor was not the only factor. Demography, regional insecurity, and Southern culture all encouraged the overwhelming acceptance of violence by almost everyone in the society. Like Southerners, Northerners also accepted high rates of violence in certain spheres of their lives. The North's increasingly dense urban spaces, especially Lower Manhattan, produced legendary stories of thieves, bare-knuckle fighters, and outright gang warfare. Though few places were as rough as Five Points, the notorious Bowery neighborhood ruled by immigrant gangs. Boston, Philadelphia, and a host of second-tier northern cities incubated dangerous neighborhoods defined by routine violence. In these same places, working-class men also resorted to unruly and sometimes violent street protests in response to bad working conditions and anger over competition with immigrants. These street actions, which happened in southern cities as well, sustained the Revolutionary-era practice of joining public destruction and personal violence to political protest. Yet another group of Northerners marshaled public violence against slavery. From 1835 to 1861, Americans participated in at least 1,200 riots, many of them designed to protest or protect slavery. In the Christiana riot, for instance, a mixed group of free blacks and their white neighbors helped protect a group of runaway slaves who had reached the security of Pennsylvania. In this riot, the defenders killed one of the slave catchers sent to return the newly freed people to bondage. Episodes of this sort happened all along slavery's border, and they generated conflict between blacks and whites, and among whites from either side of the struggle. One scholar notes that by the mid-1830s, vigilance committees had been established by African Americans in the major cities of the East Coast. These groups armed themselves, trained, and actively defended their own people and runaways escaping slavery. Blacks had been resisting slavery in the South since its inception, and by the 1830s, some whites joined in the effort. But this change produced deep divisions within the anti-slavery community. Many reformers had come to abolition through the evangelical revivals of the 1820s and 1830s, and these people often advocated a rigid pacifism. So even as a strategy of violence helped bridge racial gaps in the movement, it produced new rifts among whites. The violence directed against slavery was a precursor and partly a cause of the violence of war. Herman Melville famously referred to John Brown and his 1859 raid on Harper's Ferry as the meteor of the war, foreshadowing the coming conflict. The most famous instance of political violence over slavery in antebellum America, the caning of Massachusetts Senator Charles Sumner in 1856, spurred the growth of the Republican Party and accelerated the sense of sectional alienation. But what stands out from the episode is its singularity. In the days after the event, Virginia newspapers gleefully listed other abolitionist centers who deserved a beating. In Boston, abolitionists demonstrated and organized. According to one observer, if a leader, daring and reckless enough, had presented himself, he might have raised any number of men to march on Washington. But no more senators were caned, and no army marched on the Capitol. The most important effect of the violence was its impact on public attitudes in each section. In the North, one man reported that, "I have never before seen anything at all like the present state of deep, determined, and desperate feelings of hatred and hostility to the further extension of slavery and its political power." the physical violence enacted as part of the sectional conflict was tightly circumscribed, but its political and rhetorical impact rippled far beyond the individuals affected. If Sumner personified sectional violence, Kansas gave it a spatial focus. The best recent chronicle of events in the territory, Kansas became a state in 1861, describes the escalation of violence that so alarmed Easterners after 1854. The most famous event in the period was the Sack of Lawrence by pro-slavery forces, in which the Free State capital was targeted. The leading hotel was burned to the ground, newspaper presses destroyed, and several houses looted, though the only death was of a pro-slavery settler killed by falling masonry. John Brown's massacre of 5 pro-slavery settlers along Pottawatomie Creek and the later murder of 5 Free State partisans in the Murdezine massacre stand out as the deadliest events of the period. The years 1856 to 1857 witnessed frequent attacks by one camp or another, but as with the caning of Sumner, the more important change came as Kansans and Easterners, both North and South, who eagerly consumed reports of the conflict, inured themselves to the presence of violence in a political conflict that politics could not solve. The white abolitionist, John Brown, played a key role in escalating the Kansas conflict. He also led the most dramatic northern attack on slavery in American history. In 1859, he directed a small group of men in an assault on the U.S. Armory and arsenal at Harper's Ferry, Virginia, intending to distribute the weapons he seized to enslaved people in the state, whom he would then guide to freedom. The raid failed when the U.S. government dispatched soldiers to suppress it, as they had in previous slave rebellions going back to the nation's founding. Like the Sumner caning, the public reaction to the Brown raid on Harper's Ferry belied its small scale. Southerners regarded it as proof that abolitionists desired not only the end of slavery, but the end of white Southerners as well. Most actual abolitionists venerated Brown but repudiated his actions. The raid's violence and ironies, its first victim was a free black watchman for the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad, made them reluctant to commit to such extreme methods. Justifying war. Americans' reactions to the ubiquity and varieties of violence in the antebellum world offer only part of the context for understanding how the Civil War was fought. We must also investigate American attitudes toward war. Steeped as they were in European history, most educated Americans regarded military conflict as inevitable, and many viewed it as an affirming signal of national maturity. A general sense of war's creative and productive possibilities was widely shared. The first true pacifists in the American experience emerged out of the religious awakening of the 1830s and 1840s. In the midst of the Mexican-American War, for instance, William Lloyd Garrison declared, "A moral abhorrence which war excites in my soul, so strong that it causes me instinctively to recoil whenever I see a soldier, as I should see a rattlesnake running at large." This categorical opposition to war was regarded by many as not only naive, but absurd. Nonetheless, Americans, like their European counterparts of the time, recognized boundaries around warfare. Who could create wars, and how could they be fought? The answers to these important questions determined what was a just conflict. These questions were not simply academic. As Henry Halleck explained in his treatise on international law, all modern ethical writers regard an unjust war as not only immoral, but as one of the greatest of crimes, murder on a large scale. The first question could be answered easily. States could wage wars. In an era before modern non-governmental organizations, the only legitimate international actors were nation-states. The question of who comprised a nation contains much of the core problem of the American Civil War, but regardless of whether participants recognized the Confederacy as an independent state, they all regarded nation-states as the sole actors in war. The issue of how wars should be fought, of what qualified as just conduct, elicited a much wider range of responses. Although both Northerners and Southerners claimed adherence to a supposedly timeless conception of just war, they, like their European peers, also recognized the situational nature of just behavior in military conflicts. Contrary to popular conceptions of the United States as maintaining an isolationist stance until well into World War I, 19th century Americans regarded domestic and foreign policy as reciprocal and dynamic. The most important public policies of the early Republic and antebellum eras concerned expansion, development, and trade, all of which encouraged American growth by protecting and fostering markets overseas. The Civil War era was no different. The ways people on each side chose to fight reflected both immediate military and political concerns and the wider global resonance and judgment of such practices. Participants in the war also defined justice in relation to each other. The historical experience of the Civil War reveals that, in practice, just war is more dynamic than the transhistorical theory it claims to be. Nationhood and sovereignty. If only nations could fight wars, what made a nation? This was the question of the century, as ethnic and linguistic communities built nation-states across Europe and the Americas. In the process, 19th century Westerners labored to establish the nation as the neutral and universal form of political community. Elite Americans and their peers in Europe regarded the nation as the final stage in political development. This was most visible in the legal treatises on international law, an old body of thought that touched on trade, diplomacy, migration, and conflict. Henry Wheaton's definitive Elements of International Law, in its sixth edition by the start of the Civil War, declared that the peculiar subjects of international law are nations. The centrality of nations to global trade, diplomacy, and war only increased the importance of clarifying their foundations. An honest accounting would have seen a global conversation about the mechanisms by which people could dissolve and rebuild new political entities, something along the lines of what flourished briefly in the wake of World War I. In the event, national leaders forestalled this effort. The creation of nations reflected local and situational power struggles as much as it did any broader effort to capitalize on a natural affinity among people of a defined area. The differing demands of these contests ensured that elites in any given country sought to project their nations as natural and perpetual entities, which required obscuring the actual historical origins of such places. This was more complicated in the United States, where the American Revolution clearly marked an origin moment. To help naturalize America, national histories of the early 19th century identified the gradual coalescence of Americans as a people in the 18th century British colonial world. The success of this effort to create a permanent and inviolable American nation was tested in the secession crisis of 1861. If the Southern people comprised an autonomous nation, they could claim a right to govern themselves. If the United States comprised the only legitimate American nation, then Southerners could assert their rights as a minority section, but could not dissolve the whole. The initial federal response to this elemental threat was temporizing. The secession of seven Deep South states in late 1860 and early 1861 paralyzed President James Buchanan. He denounced the constitutionality of Southern withdrawal from the Union, but believed he was unable to act against it. Buchanan proclaimed that the executive has no authority to decide what shall be the relations between the federal government and the states, and believed that their duty to solve the problem devolved upon Congress. Bravely, he counseled, "The course of events is so rapidly hastening forward that the emergency may soon arise, when you may be called upon to decide the momentous question whether you possess the power by force of arms to compel a state to remain in the Union." Although he believed in federal supremacy, Buchanan offered no plan to maintain it in the event of secession. It may be safely asserted that the power to make war against a state is at variance with the whole spirit and intent of the Constitution, he announced. Buchanan personified the problem of sovereignty at the heart of the Civil War. He seemed not to understand who had the authority to make or unmake a nation. Southerner fire-eaters filled the vacuum left by Buchanan's inaction. They strived to establish both the coherence of a unique Southern nation and the legitimacy of asserting such a project from within the existing United States. To do so, they emphasized the natural right of a people, defined with great selectivity, to determine their own political future. The fluid nature of nation building in the 19th century offered them hope. Henry Halleck's definition of statehood seemed to hold promise for would-be Confederates. "A sovereign state," he wrote, "may therefore be defined to be any nation or people organized into a body politic and exercising the right of self-government." After Deep South delegates created the Confederacy on February 4, 1861, in Montgomery, Alabama, they claimed themselves to be a body politic deserving of sovereignty and recognition. Southerners also drew support from Wheaton's Elements of International Law. Confederate ambassadors carried copies of Wheaton's work with them when they traveled abroad. Perhaps they wanted to avail themselves of his particularly modern framework for thinking about sovereignty and statehood. Wheaton recognized that states did not require external support to establish legitimacy, offering a framework that passed no judgment on the ideological purpose or composition of a state. He affirmed that it is a state because it exists. From Lincoln's election in November through the early 1861 creation of the Confederacy, Southern elites advanced an interpretation of American constitutional history that legitimized the new nation. Jefferson Davis led this effort in his inaugural address. According to Davis, the creation of the Confederacy illustrates the American idea that governments rest upon the consent of the governed, and that it is the right of the people to alter or abolish governments whenever they become destructive of the ends for which they were established. Because this slaveholding conservative rejected the label of revolutionary, Davis needed to show continuity rather than change. "We have changed the constituent parts, but not the system of our government. We have a light which reveals its true meaning." In many of his public addresses, Davis articulated the state compact theory of the Constitution, asserting the states as the proper actors in the case of secession. The trend of the early 19th century was toward liberal nationalism, producing states that broadened access to property, curtailed the power of hierarchical institutions like the Catholic Church in Latin America, and expanded the franchise. But there was nothing inevitable about this alignment. It was, as the second half of the century showed, possible to create a new popular nation on behalf of a conservative politics, as happened in Germany. Rather than rehash the debate about whether white Southerners had a legitimate right to secede, we need to understand how they went about asserting that right. Confederates emphasized this effort because it was central to their bid for independence and their hopes of legitimizing the Confederacy as a sovereign nation, and especially because only a sovereign nation could legitimately make war. The fire-eaters who led Southern states from the Union pursued secession in a manner that anticipated this challenge. Most importantly, they claimed to instigate and pursue the process through regular democratic means. In the Deep South, popularly elected representatives attended special conventions that decided the issue. In the Upper South, the decisions of similar conventions were also subject to popular referendums. The question of whether secession received popular support is a hard one to answer. In southern states outside South Carolina, popular support for secession, as measured by votes for convention candidates committed for or against remaining in the Union, exceeded 50% of eligible voters, but often just barely. The limits of universal white male suffrage as the marker for a true democracy are obvious today, but received little attention in the South at the time. White Southerners trumpeted the fact that a majority of those empowered with the right to vote in a majority of the Southern states supported secession. Would-be Confederates believed that they possessed popular support, a historical claim, and a compelling economic case for secession. In their eyes, secession and war were just acts. Northerners disagreed. They regarded the United States in 1860 as a sovereign state, unable to dissolve as white Southerners proposed. Lincoln dismissed secession as the essence of anarchy, as did many Southern conservatives. White Southerners' decision to destroy the American government because they were unhappy with the outcome of a presidential election seemed sheer madness. The dissent of a minority, explained the conservative North American Review, may be entitled to respectful attention, but it cannot furnish the rule of government. To do so would threaten self-government itself. According to Lincoln, if secession succeeded, the lesson of political instability would doom democracy as a global experiment. Northerners marshaled historical, legal, and economic arguments of their own, all of which emphasized the perpetuity of the Union. Travers Twiss, the other key interpreter of international law alongside Wheaton and Halleck, emphasized the cardinal right upon which all others hinge, that of self-preservation. For these writers and for the many Northerners who absorbed their view on international law, the American nation was an inviolable unity, justified in defending its integrity against enemies both foreign and domestic. Lincoln and Northerners took refuge with Wheaton as well, who asserted that sovereignty is the supreme power by which any state is governed. This power may be exercised either internally or externally. He categorized the American Union in unequivocal terms as permanent. It is not merely a league of sovereign states, Wheaton wrote, but a supreme federal government, or composite state, acting not only upon the sovereign members of the Union, but directly upon all its citizens in their individual and corporate capacities. Northerners emphasized the permanence of the federal Union. The Confederate assault on Fort Sumter, U.S. property in the harbor of Charleston, South Carolina, constituted a rebellion against the legitimate authority of the national government. Henry Halleck's definition of civil wars fit the bill perfectly. Those which result from hostile operations carried on between different parts of the same state, like the War of the Roses in England or recent factions in Mexico. Some scholars believe that a state's standing depends on whether foreign powers recognize it, in which case the Confederacy must be regarded as a failure. Foreign powers played a pivotal role in establishing the sovereignty of the U.S. government during the Revolution and in sustaining it during the Civil War. Britain, France, and Russia all refused to recognize the Confederacy as an independent nation. In doing so, they explicitly sanctioned Lincoln's claim that the Washington government exercised legitimate authority over Southern citizens. The British and French, both dominant global actors with grand colonial pretensions, understood that casting Confederates in the position of rebels against established power weakened the ability of white Southerners to mount their campaign for autonomy. More importantly, From the European perspective, it helped create a precedent for central power over that of subnational or ethnic communities that might one day push against London or Paris. As much as theories of justice and natural rights might have informed debates about just war, we should not underestimate the influence of geopolitics and strategy. Defensive war. Southern fire-eaters dismissed the likelihood of a war in public, but few believed that the United States would let the South leave in peace. War could only be fought by nations, and just wars only by just people. Most new Confederates felt they had established the moral and legal legitimacy of the Confederacy in February, having created their state. Confederates prepared for war. The Confederate Secretary of State emphasized as much in his instructions to the foreign deputies sent to Europe in March. You will not fail to explain that in withdrawing from the United States, the Confederate States have not violated any obligations of sovereignty. They have merely exercised the sovereignty which they have possessed since their separation from Great Britain and jealously guarded. Both Northerners and Southerners labored to prove to themselves and to the world that they had the right to make war. Ancient and modern scholars of just war agree that states can resort to war only when they are attacked or face an imminent threat of such an attack. Offensive war violates the cardinal principle of just war doctrine, that states have a natural right to self-defense, but not to committing violence against others. Defining imminent threat can be a tricky proposition. Strictly speaking, Confederates fired the first shot when they turned their cannons on a U.S. military installation, Fort Sumter. As Lincoln had hoped, this empowered the United States to adopt a defensive posture. People at the time disagreed about when, where, and why the Civil War started, and historians have faithfully maintained this tradition. As in recent conflicts, both sides advocated a particular chronology that demonstrated to the world the justness of their respective causes. Southerners had a harder pitch to make, as they knew at the time. The Confederates attacked Fort Sumter before a supply ship arrived in April 1861. Although some Southern papers argued that Lincoln's decision to resupply the fort represented a hostile act, they seemed to sense the weakness of their position. The stronger Southern argument, one that fire-eaters had been making in different forms since at least the mid-1850s, was that the North's refusal to observe their obligations under the Constitution, especially the return of runaway slaves, effectively relieved Southerners of their duty to respect federal authority. That is, they were not rebels against a legitimate government, but conservatives seeking to uphold the original American faith against its appropriation by Northern radicals. In the words of one Confederate congressional resolution, "The war in which we are now engaged with the government and people of the United States was not provoked or inaugurated by the Confederate States, and is now prosecuted and maintained by them only in vindication of the highest and most sacred rights of a people resolved to be free and independent." This position had the merit of being grounded in a consideration of how polities organized themselves. As Southerners also knew, the constitutional pose reflected an essentially unanswerable question about when and how people can reorganize their national connections and institutions. But the lack of a clear answer did not dissuade Confederate thinkers from asserting the justice of their cause. Even more, as one historian notes, secessionists tried to reassure everyone that their crusade was a holy one. In the language of just war theory, they claimed jus ad bellum, a legitimate right to make war. Like Davis, Lincoln understood he must win world opinion on the question of who had jus ad bellum. Accordingly, he explained the war's origins in a way that cast the North as a victim. As he described the difference between the Confederacy and the United States, One of them would make war rather than let the nation survive, and the other would accept war rather than let it perish. More significantly, he crafted a response to the Southern contention that a popular minority could constitutionally dissolve their relationship as a part of the American nation. Lincoln conceived of the Union as perpetual and secession as impossible. Perpetuity is implied, if not expressed, in the fundamental law of all national governments. Lincoln wrote, "It is safe to assert that no government proper ever had a provision in its organic law for its own termination." From his earliest experiences with government, Lincoln cherished, even worshipped, the rule of law. Secession, predicated on Southerners' fears over the consequences of electing a Republican president, rejected that rule. As a Whig, Lincoln had grown used to seeing his party lose national elections. The remedy for an election that did not produce the desired result was to wait and try again. As Lincoln saw it, secession destroyed self-government because everyone who disliked the outcome of an election, at whatever level, could simply proclaim independence. In democracies, he wrote, there could be no appeal from the ballot to the bullet. So in response to Southerners' contention that secession was a preemptive strike against an imminent threat from the federal government, Lincoln averred that not only was secession undemocratic, secession made democracy impossible. Davis and Lincoln directed their arguments for their respective national sovereignties at both external and internal audiences. To function as a nation, they needed the respect and support of other nations. More importantly, they needed to inspire their own people. Neither man anticipated the full scope of the war that came, but both knew that they faced skeptical, divided publics, and that war of any sort would require a firm moral foundation. The challenge for each administration was to explain their own posture in a way that convinced their public of their righteousness. Once justice had been proven, they could expect not just an eager public, but a committed one, ready to bear sacrifice and weather setbacks, secure in the authority of their cause. The sovereignty struggle was never an even fight. The United States began the war with an 80-year history as an independent nation. The Confederacy could claim only 2 months. Lincoln exploited that difference and sought every opportunity to deny the independence of the Confederacy. In his writing, he used rebellion far more often than civil war. Despite its assumption of a dispute among common people, civil war granted too much autonomy to the Confederacy. He often referred to it as the Confederate States, with quotation marks, or the so-called Confederate States. This was both a logical consequence of his belief in a perpetual union and one of his rhetorical weapons against the Confederacy. The Confederates, for their part, recognized the United States as a legitimate member of the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.